This is Transfer Pricing Associates in Amsterdam. It's 6 o'clock here, and we want to remind all of the attendees that all materials will be available within 1 week on the tpaglobal.com website, so you can go there and check those out. And we will also be sending out emails to the attendees and participants with links to the material following this event. Again, we'll be starting in a couple of minutes once a couple of people have logged on here that we're waiting for.
So I'm starting now. Good morning, everyone. My name is Amit Maheshwari, and I'm an alliance partner of TPA Global. I'm here to give a presentation on the safe harbor rules, which were introduced in India. The presentation would be available later on the website of TPA within a week. I would also be available for a one-to-one follow-up in case you require that. I'll be starting off the presentation now. So, the topic for today is safe harbor rules introduced in India. The agenda is safe. We will be going through what is safe harbor, the Indian history, key features of Indian safe harbor rules, the procedure to be followed to avail the benefits under the safe harbor rules, the threshold limits, the definition modified in the final rules, what are the drawbacks of this safe harbor in India, what to watch out for going forward, and then we will conclude this presentation. So, what exactly is safe harbor? Safe harbor is a provision that applies to a defined category of taxpayers or transactions that relieve them from certain obligations otherwise imposed by a country's general transfer pricing rules. So, in countries like India, you already have a kind of safe harbor in place, which was not codified, but according to which, in case your transaction is below 10 million Indian rupees, then you were excluded from the rigorous documentation which is there in the Indian Income Tax Act. So countries like USA, Australia, and other developed countries have come out with safe harbor rules, giving relief in certain cases which they think are probably not material or do not affect the revenues as such, or even in cases like India where they think that the amount stuck up in litigation is too high. So safe harbor is a premium paid over the arm's length price. So we have to remember it's not an arm's length price. It's a premium paid over the arm's length price for providing certainty to the taxpayers. It has benefits both for the taxpayers as well as the revenue authorities. Taxpayers know exactly what price to set to be within the safe harbor limit and avoid any additions on that account. For the revenue authorities, it helps them in making their budgets. They know how much revenue to expect, and it does not get stuck up in unnecessary litigation, which is costly both for the revenue as well as for the taxpayers. Observations show that safe harbor were introduced with the primary objective of addressing the specific needs of a particular country. For example, Australia, New Zealand, and Singapore introduced them to reduce administrative rigors in low-value transactions. Mexico introduced them for contract manufacturing by MNC units primarily for export purposes. In the United States of America, because USA being the headquarters of large corporations, they introduced safe harbor so that all the relevant costs which are incurred for groups' benefit are charged to their overseas entities. So that has been the experience with safe harbor, and as and what is required by the tax authorities of those countries, as per their policy, they bring out these safe harbors selectively. It's not a blanket provision applied across. A lot of what goes behind it. Now, why safe harbor? So, safe harbor simplifies compliances, it provides certainty, reduces disputes, It relieves tax administration from audit of taxpayer, enabling better utilization of the resources. So instead of auditing those small transactions or low-risk transactions or probably those taxpayers, the resources are freed up to pursue other cases. So what has been the criticism to safe harbor? So as per the OECD discussion draft on released on safe harbor, there was reluctance by countries to adopt safe harbor. The primary reasons for the criticism or the kinds of criticism were, it was very difficult to establish a satisfactory criteria for safe harbor. So it's very difficult what percentage to set. It's cost plus 20, cost plus 10, it's cost plus 7. A lot of research goes on, which could be quite extensive when it's done. Now, the problem is, if you get into these extensive researches, spend too much time into it, then the basic premise on which safe harbor were going to be formulated, that is to save time, to save resources of the revenue, that itself gets defeated. So you have to be very sure that the research is limited, it's as per the best international best practices. At the same time, you do not invest, none of the government would like to invest too much time into it. The other point, which is also a point of criticism for safe harbor, is there is an unfair distribution of tax between jurisdictions. So you have jurisdictions wherein one jurisdiction may say that, okay, India would say cost plus 20 is fine with us. Then the other jurisdiction will say, will have a problem. So the MNCs operating in India will try to make their price at cost plus 20, which is not obviously not an arm's length price, and the other country would unfairly lose out on the revenues which could have come in. So this is another criticism, very important criticism of safe harbor rules. The other is double taxation. So most of the countries which have adopted safe harbor rules are unilateral in nature. They are not bilateral, because globally the countries move on an arm's length principle. So if one country adopts a safe harbor rule, in all probability it would not be an arm's length price. So the other country would not give a corresponding credit to the increased or the inflated transfer price of the transaction. So this also results in double taxation. The treaties do not have an option of giving a relief in these cases. So wherever there is an element of double taxation which is significant enough, it's better to go for an advanced pricing agreement of a bilateral nature, which is allowed in India, so that there is no double taxation and there is no loss. In case the loss is not very material, then a unilateral safe harbor would work very well. Knowing the experience of multinationals in India, the kind of disputes they have faced, the kind of additions which have happened. Safe harbor also shifts the administrative burden. So, for example, if India has introduced a safe harbor, probably the other country, the parent country, would have to check whether the price they are getting from the Indian subsidiary or the Indian associated enterprises are at arm's length. They will have to get into extensive details to make sure that they don't lose out the revenue. So India has probably reduced its administrative burden, but on the other hand, the administrative burden of other countries have increased. So that has been the criticism to safe harbor mentioned by many OECD countries, also discussed in their discussion draft. So it also gives tax planning opportunities for companies having better than average profitability. So you safe harbor, you come out with an average which is acceptable to all, but there are certain outliers to that average. So those companies who are actually having margins higher than the safe harbor limit may use this to their advantage and deflate their prices and do intelligent tax planning techniques. Another issue is similar, related to the last one, is it raises equity and uniformity issues. Similar taxpayers subjected to different tax treatments, which could entail discrimination and competitive distortions. So having safe harbor poses a risk to equity. Companies who will do not go for the safe harbor regime are subjected to vigorous audits. Their price could be even higher than safe harbor, could be lower, they could get into disputes. So it has an equity issue. So these were the basic criticism to safe harbor. Does anybody have a question till now? You can use the Q&A button from the drop-down menu at the top, and I can respond to your questions. So I have received a query that which are the countries that apply safe harbor. So OECD discussion draft discusses that. I also have a list of country-wise practices which I can share if you can drop an email to me, or I probably, once we give a feedback, so you can respond to that, and I can give you a list of the countries which apply safe harbor. Any questions till now? You can click on the Q&A button and pose your questions. Okay, so now I will move to the next slide. So now we will talk about the Indian history. In the Finance Act of 2009, the Indian Income Tax Act was amended to empower the Central Bureau of Direct Taxes, which is the Apex Tax Administration Authority, to issue transfer pricing safe harbor rules. That happened in 2009. Even then, obviously, all of us know that the kind of investment climate which India is facing now because of some controversial tax policies and the stringent tax administration which has happened. But even back in 2009, our finance minister recognized this and said, in order to further improve the investment climate, we need to facilitate the resolution of tax disputes faced by foreign companies within a reasonable time. He identified certain sectors which needed it very badly, and to reduce the judgmental impact of transfer price, he proposed to empower the Central Board of Direct Taxes to formulate the safe harbor rules. So India, if I may share a statistics, India in the last transfer pricing audit cycle did additions worth $11 billion. That is huge. So every second case fixed for detailed scrutiny assessment got additions done. So this is something, in 2009 it was quite less. This time it's increasing manifold. So this safe harbor is a very welcome step. You have recently had an advanced pricing agreement rules also finalized. Safe harbor rules is again a very welcome step, considering that you had so much litigation in India. Any questions here? Please feel free to put in the Q&A section, and send it to the host and presenter both. I will move on to the next slide. In between, you can pose your questions. So, on 14th of August 2013, nearly 4 years after the Finance Act was amended, the Central Board of Direct Taxes released the safe harbor rules for public comments. very quickly by 18th of September, they took all the comments from all stakeholders and released the final safe harbor rules. So India is moving very fast now in convincing multinationals that India is open for business. You can save, you can come here, don't worry about your taxes. This is the message which the finance minister is sending through his roadshows, and it's actually now also happening on ground. So very quickly, within a month, they finalized it. There was quite a lot of criticism in the safe, in the draft rules. Most of them were taken care of, and now many multinationals are free, are very happy about the developments. Any questions on the Indian history, please? Anything you want to know? Okay, I will move ahead. So the key, what are the key features of the Indian Safe Harbor Rules? So the key features are the transfer price is it's basically a safe harbor relating to price and not to the administrative part. So transfer pricing, transfer price is accepted if it is within the safe harbor limit. There is no relief from the rigorous documentation which is prescribed under the Indian transfer pricing regime. So we have a rule which has very extensive documentation requirements as per the international best practices. You have to send out a whole lot of details like your company profile, group profile, your FAR analysis, economic characterizations, things like that. So they said you still have to maintain this. The reason could be probably that the documentation, the intention behind not giving a relief from documentation is that unless and until they see the documentation, they can never come to know whether you are eligible for this or not, whether you fall within the criteria of safe harbor or not. So that seems to be the intention behind it. Third thing is, whenever an option of safe harbor is exercised, MAP route is closed, leading to double taxation. So you can't go for a mutual agreement procedure. MAP route is closed. That makes this safe harbor unilateral. Certain countries are studying this, as studying safe, their safe harbor, revisiting it, trying to make it a bilateral safe harbor. But as of now, India is unilateral. MAP route is closed. In case you opt for this, you have to stop that route. The Indian safe harbor will also not apply when associated enterprises are located in no tax or low tax country or territory. By no tax or low tax country, they mean a country where the maximum rate of incorporate tax is 15%. Another good thing about the Indian safe harbor rules is you can opt out of safe harbor. You can move out, and which was not there in the draft rule, so they have come out with this. Any questions till now? You can use the Q&A button on the drop-down menu at the top. Now coming to the procedural part, how do you actually apply for a safe harbor in India? The taxpayer has to file a form 3CEFA to the assessing officer before the due date of filing of return of income. The safe harbor rules, so in case it's exercised for 1 year, you have to file it in that year. If it's exercised for more than 1 year, up to 5 years, then you have to do it in the very first year. So as part of the application, the following details are to be provided: details of the taxpayer, details of the year in which it's applied for, particulars of each eligible international transaction, along with the transfer price declared. The form has to be signed. But the important point here is the crux of this, the procedure. just filing an application does not entitle you to the benefits. The officer will study your application and decide whether they will give you the safe harbor, they will allow you to avail safe, come within the safe harbor rules or not. But they have to do that within 2 months. So again, a very stringent deadline. They have to do it. In case they do not do it, your application would be accepted. So again, a very stringent deadline. They have a definite timeline. They have to do it. If not, then you don't have a problem. It cannot be challenged. In case you have a problem with what the assessing the officer has, the view the officer has taken, in case he rejects that, you have an option of filing an appeal. You can do that. The safe harbor, once excised, will remain in force for the specified period or the period of 5 years, whichever is less. So before moving on to the next slide, I would request any questions. I just received a question that does the government decide the margins of transfer pricing? So in India, the transfer price has to be done by the taxpayer, but it is tested by the authorities. They want to maintain a contemporaneous documentation and a transfer pricing report and documentation and report are made, which benchmark these prices with other comparable companies, arrive at an arithmetic mean. So in most of the developed nations, in most of the OECD countries, you have an interquartile range. In India, you have an arithmetic mean. So based on the arithmetic mean, they test the price and see whether it's at arm's length or not. In the safe harbor rules, they have come out with defined margins. To avail the benefit, you will necessarily have to have margins over and above that. Then only you will qualify for this. I hope the question has been answered. I will move on to the next part of the slide. The threshold limits. What are the threshold limits which have been specified? So not all sectors in India are covered by safe harbor rules. You have software development and information technology services, which obviously, as everybody knows, India is a leading provider of software services, outsourced services, and ITES. So in software development services, they have said an operating margin of not less than 20% would be accepted if your aggregate value of transaction do not exceed 5 crore Indian rupees. Not less than 22% if they exceed 500 crore Indian rupees. So they earlier had a limit of restricting the safe harbor rules to only companies having international transactions of less than 100 crore rupees. But on the representations made, they removed that threshold, and now it is open for everybody. It's at when you are a large service provider, your margins go up to, you have to be more than 22%. Again, as I said, the impact of double taxation has to be kept in mind, especially in case of large providers, where this could turn out to be very material amounts. Operating margin in case of knowledge process outsourcing units, which includes your data analytics, financial analytics, and other high-end stuff, the operating profit margin should not be less than 25%. Now, all these definitions, whatever I'm telling you, software development services, ITES, KPOs, they are well defined in the rules. You can look at the definitions there and see whether the case falls there or not. So who is an eligible taxpayer? It's written below. They want only entities which bear insignificant risk, such that the foreign principal performs most of the economically significant functions, provides capital and other economically significant assets, including intangibles, controls, supervises the entire development which is happening, the entire processes. The important thing here is the insignificant risk. They have also defined what insignificant risk is. You have to make sure you fall in that. Most of the captive service providers in India claim to be, and most of them from US claim to be, insignificant risk-bearing entities. But when it comes to substantiating that with documentation, most of them fall short of substantiating how you are an insignificant risk provider. I'll move on to the next slide. So you have contract research development services, wholly or partly related to software development. Here the operating profit margin are not less than 30%. In generic drugs contract R&D, it's not less than 29%. Again, you have what is an eligible taxpayer. You have entities bearing insignificant risk, performing most of the economically significant functions. It's the same thing which we repeated earlier, so I'm not going to repeat that. Again, all of them, given their bottom line is, you should be an insignificant risk entity. The moment you don't do that, you are out of safe harbor, because they are only covering the least risky from a revenue point of view. Though it's a different story that most of the companies do not end up being insignificant and face additions, but they generally get relief in the higher appellate authorities. So anybody has any questions till now? I would be more than happy to take them right now. Advancing of intra-group loans. Again, from a revenue standpoint, a low-risk item which can be defined very easily. They say if you give an intra-group loan from an Indian company to their overseas subsidiaries, then if it does not exceed 50 crore Indian rupees, the base rate of State Bank of India, which is the largest public sector bank in India, would be taken plus 150 basis point. If it exceeds 50 crores, it will be base rate plus 300 basis points. So an important point is that this will apply only when the money is sourced in Indian rupees. So just to reiterate, an Indian company having branches abroad giving loan to their overseas subsidiary would have to do it at this price to interest to avail the safe harbor rule. So even if they give loans in foreign currency or Indian currency, the bottom line is they have obtained it in Indian rupees. So they take the opportunity cost of India. Obviously, we have a high interest rate regime in India. So that is why these higher rates. You have provision for corporate guarantees. So if it does not exceed 100 crores, your fees would be 2% per annum. If it exceeds 100 crores, it would be 1.75%. One thing which they could have done would have been put on slabs so that when you actually sit in negotiations in banks, if the higher the guarantee amount, the lower the commission and the fees. So they could have even extended it to further slabs, but in their own judgment, they have not done that. Then you also have manufacturer and export of core auto components, where the operating margin has been defined as less than 20%. In non-core auto components, it is less than 8.5%. By core auto components, you mean engine, gears, transmission equipment, etc. Again, all these definitions have been defined. You can refer that. For non-core, anything which is not core has been defined as non-core auto components. So you had those draft safe harbor rules in which many of the items were rationalized. One was they rationalized the KPO definition to serve. They included services requiring application of knowledge and advanced analytical and technical skills. income tax expense was excluded from the definition of operating expense. Corporate guarantee did not include letter of comfort, implicit corporate guarantee, performance guarantee, which ideally should not have been included. So that this is another good thing which they have done. They have defined what do they mean by generic pharmaceutical drug. It means a drug that is comparable to drugs already approved in performance criteria. Definition of ITE, ITS, software development, excludes R&D and contract. Corporate guarantees exceeding 100 crores are also under the safe harbor. So earlier in the draft safe harbor rules, you had thresholds in almost everything. If you are more than 100 crores transactions, you won't be coming in safe harbor. So most of them have been done away with. Anybody has any questions till now? Okay, I have a question from a learned audience member. They say, how does safe harbor result in double taxation? So, though I have elaborately discussed that, but I would just explain it very quickly by giving an example. Let's say you are a captive software arm of a multinational based out of US. As per the Indian safe harbor rule, your margin should be your operating profit margin should be 20% at the lower end of the threshold. When you do that, the other country, the India would accept it, but the other country will say, why an operating margin of 20% if you're an insignificant risk provider? We will allow only 17%. So in the last MAP proceedings, which happened in software with United States of America, both the competent authorities agreed on a margin of 17.5%. So this is higher than that. So the other countries would not allow this higher margin and would not give a corresponding tax expense. They would not allow the expense to reduce the taxable income in the home country. The treaties cannot resolve that. Therefore, this would result in double taxation. All the companies would have to do a proper cost-benefit analysis to understand whether this amount of tax foregone as a double tax, as a unnecessary tax paid in India, would that exceed the benefits derived by safe harbor by reducing the expenses in litigation, by freeing up money locked in litigation? They have to see it on a group as a whole. If it makes sense to them, they will do it. We expect small players to go for this, not very large service providers. For them, bilateral APA would be a solution. I hope I have answered this. I have got another question which says, how do the Indian authorities define what is insignificant risk? So this is a very good question. I will just read out what they very briefly what this mean by insignificant risk. What was written in the slides at the bottom is actually the crux of it. So you have to make sure that the foreign principal performs the economically significant functions. They provide the capital, assets, they control under the direct supervision. This is very important. They do not assume economically significant risk. So the foreign principal has to have that risk with themselves. In India, India has made their position very clear in the United Nations country practices that we will not blindly go by the contract. We will not just by the words or wordings of the contract, we will not say that the risk has been transferred abroad. it has to follow the functions and the assets. Only by the conduct of the party we will be satisfied that yes, the risk has actually gone out. So India has clearly said that in the Indian safe harbor rules, the basic bone of contention would be how do you get out of insignificant risk? How do you make sure the Indian unit has insignificant risk? That is going to pose a lot of problem, and it has to be well documented, made sure that all the documents are in place. Only then the taxpayer would be eligible for safe harbor rule. So any other questions, please let me know. I am moving on to the next slide. I can take it afterwards as well. Please feel free to use the Q&A button. So what are the drawbacks of the Indian safe harbor rules? So Indian safe harbor regime had given the government had given a leeway of 3% deviation from the arm's length price. If you were within 3% of the arm's arm's length price, so they allowed a deviation that has not been allowed in safe harbor. Whatever percentages are there, that are fixed. Even if you are, let's say, a company in the very first year of operation, you are struggling to show the margins, you still have to stick by that percentage. There's absolutely no leeway provided in this. The other drawback is they do not give relief from documentation, which is quite extensive. Even for small players, it is actually a very burdensome, very costly affair. This we have already discussed. They will result in double taxation. Bigger players would have to go for normal documentation audits, giving rise to litigation. There is no clarification that safe harbor rules will not be treated as a rebuttable assumption. By this we mean that the officers on ground would actually should not use these prices as a yardstick to compare companies which are not under the safe, which are not opted for safe harbor regime. That is very important. So you have officers thinking that a cost plus 20% or a cost plus 22% is something which is an arm's length price. So they have to be educated. The Rangachari committee, on the basis of which these rules were formed, requested the government to come out with clarification. The submissions, the representations which we gave to the government, we told them, please clarify that this is not an arm's length price. Don't use it either in the APA or in other normal scrutiny assessment cases, but they did not do that. Some margins seem typically to be higher side, even considering the premium safe harbor has over arm's length price due to certainty. But still, especially in that economic downturn which India is in, they seem to be on a higher side. As I said, determination of what is insignificant risk could turn out to be an exhaustive and time-consuming exercise. Again, as I mentioned, safe harbor on guarantee commission could have been based on slabs. So you could have multiple slabs because this is how banks negotiate. So these are the basic drawbacks of safe harbor rules, which we think could potentially spoil the party, and there could not be many takers for safe harbor rules. But as I said, there are arguments to both sides of it. Many countries are still apprehensive about safe harbor rules. So only time will tell how it turns out to be. So what exactly have to have you have to watch out for? That you have to make sure that the taxpayer remains at entity of bearing insignificant risk in respect of IT, ITS, KPO, software R&D, and pharma R&D. Make sure they remain an insignificant risk provider. The eligibility definition should be carefully interpreted to avoid any future disputes, because if you are out of the definition, if you are not an insignificant risk provider, you go out of safe harbor rules straight away and then go to the normal assessment proceeding, which could turn out to be against you because you have already declared higher margins. The facts and the circumstances on the basis of which safe harbor option was exercised remain unchanged, which does not give the AO a reason to doubt the eligibility. Now, when you go for a safe harbor, you characterize the entity, you see it's an insignificant risk provider, but your actual conduct in the subsequent years is not according to what you initially thought or envisaged. So you have to be very sure that for the taxpayer in India, the functional FAR analysis remains the same and satisfied all those criteria which have been prescribed. Your contractual conditions remain the same. Your conduct, the substantive nature of the transaction also remain the same. So probably instead of a contract manufacturer, you don't become a full-fledged manufacturer. You don't become a toll manufacturer. So this is what has to be kept in mind. Anybody having any questions till now? So coming to the concluding part of the presentation, the final rules are a welcome improvement over the draft rules which came in terms of target profit margin. They reduced them in some cases. They enhanced the coverage by removing the threshold limits, and they rationalized definitions, which I've already told you. So a lot of goods, they took into account all the suggestions by the stakeholders. It would have been better if they would have dispensed the documentation, but I think probably this is the very first year. It may come later on. We hope that this does not become a repeatable assumption, though in our experience in the APA regime, APA authorities have been very, very open, very pragmatic in their discussions with an open mind, and they have just said, they have kept aside safe harbor rules. They have said, we don't want to look at those margins. Those are not at arm's length. When you come for APA, discuss your arm's length price, and then we will negotiate it in case it's bilateral. Otherwise, unilateral, we will give it as per our agreements. So overall, the final rules are a welcome move and reflect the fact that the Indian government is keen to attract the foreign direct investment, which have actually, the finance minister had done road shows, gone abroad, told we want investments, we are open to invite to bring in multinationals in India. So this again shows that the recent developments are augmenting the fact that they are very keen to attract FDI, foreign companies, and multinationals are welcome, and their concerns are being addressed. So this is it. Any questions, please? Okay. So I've just received one question. So this is a very valid question, saying that they have been reading news of the Vodafone case in India and the the oil majors transfer pricing adjustment running into $3 billion. So as I said, that Indian government is making the right efforts to make sure that multinationals are welcome. So why are these cases happening and why do they keep happening? So in India, we have these officers which are very aggressive sometimes do not appreciate the concepts. So in India, almost 50% of the cases which are selected for scrutiny assessments get additions done on them. But almost 70% of these cases which go into appeals get released in the higher appellate authorities. So India has a very robust dispute resolution mechanism in terms of our courts. It takes time, but the courts have been really very pragmatic in their view and understand these concepts well. Even in Vodafone, the Supreme Court ruled in favor of Vodafone. It was the government which actually went back. But I think they have realized this, and they are now doing their best to make sure that there is a tax certainty with multinationals and they are comfortable. I have received another question which I will answer now. The question says, does the government expect additional proven documentation for transfer pricing? So I think this is not about safe harbor. It's the normal transfer pricing. It's the normal transfer pricing regime. So you have a very exhaustive list of documentation which is already prescribed. They don't ask for additional documents unless and until the existing documentation they do not satisfy them. So in case they need further clarification, they may still ask. And in safe harbor also documentation is required. Only through that documentation will the government, the officer come to know what exactly is the characterization of the entity, whether it's an eligible taxpayer or not, or whether the transaction is eligible for safe harbor or not. You may have multiple transactions, only three may qualify for safe harbor, rest four will not qualify. So this is what the documentation part is. Any help on documentation, I would be able to give the relevant documents required in transfer pricing in India. Any other questions, please? You can use the Q&A button from the drop-down menu and type in your questions. This is a very interesting development in India. So a lot of multinationals, especially smaller ones, would be able to now accurately set their transfer pricing when trading with India. So it's a very positive development. Any questions? Okay, I think there is no more. So as I said, this entire presentation along with the audio recording would be uploaded on the TPA Global website. You may download that. In case you have any questions, you can mail us and we will reply to you. Thank you. Thank you for your patience. Have a nice day. Thank you all.